Welcome students, I am Dr. Manjot Gautam and I'll be discussing dermatology with you. In this section, I'll be covering scabies, pediculosis and bacterial infections. Coming to the first parasitic infestation, that is scabies, it is an ectoparasite infestation caused by the mite Sarcoptes scabi. It is transmitted by close body contact, and in adults, it can also be transmitted by sexual contact. Now, when a patient comes in contact with Sarcoptes scabi mite for the first time, that is primary infestation, it takes around 1 month time for the patient to develop hypersensitivity reaction to the mite. Therefore, the incubation period is 1 month. However, on subsequent re-exposure, the patient may manifest the symptoms earlier than this. Now, let's discuss the life cycle. Now, a fertilized female lays eggs and it passes through the larval and the lymphal stage, and in around 10 to 14 days time, the adult mite is formed. Now, what are the clinical features of scabies? The patients generally present with severe pruritus that worsens at night, called as nocturnal pruritus. Now, this is very classical for scabies. Again, they'll have a positive family history. Other members in the family will also have similar complaints. The classical sites for scabies include the web spaces of the fingers, the volar aspect of the wrist, the forearms, the cubital fossae, the axillae, the periareolar region, the periumbilical region, and the genitals. Now, if we draw an imaginary circle joining all these points, now we get what is called as circle of Hebra. Coming to the morphology, burrows are the classical lesions of scabies. However, because of severe pruritus, most of the patients, when they present, the burrows have already been destroyed. So what we see is generally papillovesicular lesions and multiple excoriations at the sites that I just mentioned. Coming to the complications of scabies, the patients can have secondary bacterial infection with streptococci, which can result in glomerulonephritis and rheumatic fever. And eczematization is a very common problem in children. Now, what are the variants of scabies? What I just discussed was classical scabies. Now, there can be variants like scabies in the clean. Now, these patients have more of symptoms but less of manifestations. So, we have to have a very strong suspicion to diagnose scabies in the clean. Infantile scabies. This differs from adult scabies because in adults, generally the areas involved are below the level of the neck, whereas in infants, it can involve the scalp and also the face, and this needs to be differentiated from a condition called as atopic dermatitis, which is very common in infants. Genital scabies, exclusive lesions in the genitals, is basically a sexually transmitted infection. Nodular scabies, when the classical lesions are nodules. Keratotic or Norwegian scabies, I'll be discussing later. And scabies incognito, when because of misdiagnosis, the patient has been applying steroids, therefore the morphology of the lesions change, and then what we get is scabies incognito. The word incognito means hidden. What are the investigations that we would want to do? Well, scabies is generally a clinical diagnosis, but if we need to confirm the diagnosis, we can take scrapings of the skin lesions or the burrows and look at it under the microscope, where we'll be able to see the mite or the mite parts or even the fecal matter. Coming to treatment of scabies, we need to emphasize here that all the family members need to be treated simultaneously. The patient can be given antihistamines orally to relieve pruritus, and topical antiscabitic drugs include permethrin 5% single dose application, gamma-benzene hexachloride 1%, benzyl benzoate 25%, sulfur 5% preferred in pregnancy, and crotamiton 10% preferred in infants. However, permethrin is safe and this can also be given in pregnant ladies as well as in infants. Now, apart from permethrin, which is ovicidal, rest of the drugs need to be repeated after a period of 8 to 10 days. Because permethrin is an ovicidal drug, single dose application is more than enough. We also have an oral antiscabitic agent, that is ivermectin. A single dose of ivermectin 0.2 milligrams per kg can cure scabies. Coming to the next infestation, that is pediculosis capitis, it is caused by head louse, that is pediculus capitis. It affects women and children due to close contact. The patient generally presents with severe pruritus of the scalp. They can develop boils due to secondary infection. And on examination, what we see is the nits or the egg which are cemented to the hair, especially in the dense areas of the scalp, that is the posterior auricular region and the occipital areas of the scalp. Now, nits need to be differentiated from dandruff. As I mentioned, that nits are cemented to the hair, therefore they will be able to move only in the distal direction, whereas dandruff is dry flakes. So, dandruff can move to and fro. Also, we will be able to see the lice in heavily infested patients. Such patients may even present with occipital lymphadenopathy. Coming to the treatment for pediculosis capitis, what we can use is 1% permethrin, 1% gamma benzene hexachloride, or malathion 0.5%. Again, all the family members need to be treated simultaneously, and except for permethrin, we need to repeat the application after 10 days. Now, for removal of the nits, what we can do is ask the patient to apply vinegar, that is dilute acetic acid, for say around half an hour. Now this will dissolve the cementing substance and make the nits free from the hair. And then when we ask the patients to comb, they'll be able to even remove the nits. Also antihistamines to relieve the pruritus. Coming to pediculosis corporis, now this is body infestation with louse called as pediculus corporis. The word corporis means the body. And that's how pediculus corporis, it affects the males with poor hygiene who lack home. And that is the reason it is also called as vagabond's disease. The patients present with severe pruritus, excoriations and petechiae. One must remember that in pediculosis corporis, the lice do not reside on the skin except when they are feeding. So, in order to come to a diagnosis of pediculosis corporis, we have to examine the seams of the clothes. It is here where the nits and lice will be visible. So, the treatment generally for the patients includes symptomatic, that is give antihistamines and calamine lotion topically. Whereas here, we mainly need to treat the clothes. So, the clothes need to be disinfected. These clothes can be either discarded completely or wash these clothes in boiling hot water and press with iron, hot iron, especially taking care of the seams of the clothes. They can also be treated with DDT or gamma benzene hexachloride. Coming to pediculosis pubis, which is caused by a crab louse or the pubic louse called as thyrus pubis. Pediculosis pubis is a sexually transmitted infection. The patients present with intense pruritus over the genitals and in the surrounding areas like the inner thighs and the perineum. Thyrus pubis can also affect the eyebrows and the eyelashes. On examination of the patients, what we see are excoriations and bluish macules called as maculae cerulae. The word cerulae indicates the blue color of the lesions in the affected areas. On observation, what we see are lice and nits which are attached to the pubic hair. So coming to the treatment, the patient can be simply asked to just shave off the pubic hair and give antihistamines as symptomatic treatment. Or else, the patient can apply gamma benzene hexachloride 1%, permethrin 1% single application. Gamma benzene hexachloride needs to be repeated after 10 days. Now let's discuss the bacterial infections. The first infection that I'm going to discuss here is impetigo. It is a superficial bacterial infection which can spread through close contact and even through auto-inoculation. Now, the variants include the common variant, that is the non-bullous impetigo, which is caused by group A streptococci, or the uncommon variant, that is bullous impetigo, which is caused by Staphylococcus aureus. Impetigo is generally seen in children with poor hygiene. They present with painless vesicles or pustules. In non-bullous impetigo, the vesicles or pustules rupture very fast as compared to the bullous impetigo. They rupture, giving rise to erosions which are covered with honey-colored crust. Now, honey-colored crusts are very, very classical for impetigo. And these being superficial bacterial infections, the lesions generally heal without scarring. One of the complications with impetigo is it predisposes the patient to glomerulonephritis. Treatment includes basic oral antibiotics like cloxacillin or cefalexin, and topically the patient can use mupirocin or fusidic acid. Staphylococcal scalded skin syndrome. This is produced by a bacteria, Staphylococcus aureus, which produces the exfoliative toxin or the exotoxin. Now, the initial infection with staph aureus is generally extracutaneous. Most of the patients generally present with sore throat. This is followed by release of exfoliative toxin in the blood, and then the patient develops widespread thin-roofed blisters on an erythematous tender skin. As a result of this, once these blisters rupture, this widespread desquamation of large areas of the skin, this is positive Nikolsky's sign. That means when we apply lateral pressure on the skin peels off and results in erosions. Positive Nikolsky's sign is also seen in other conditions, which I'll be discussing later. The complications include fluid and electrolyte imbalance, loss of temperature control. And so, this is a medical emergency and the child needs to be admitted in the medical ward and treated with IV antibiotics, and we should manage the skin as we do it for burns. The next infection is ichthyma. Now, as compared to impetigo, ichthyma is a deep bacterial infection. That is, it involves the dermis and the infection is with streptococci. The site commonly involved is the lower legs of older children and younger adults. The patient presents with round, tender ulcers which are covered with thick, dark brown adherent crusts which are difficult to remove. And this being a deeper infection, it generally heals with scarring. Coming to the treatment of ichthyma, again we can give oral antibiotics like cloxacillin and cefalexin. As I mentioned that the crust is thick and adherent, we need to remove this crust. How we can do this is by asking the patient to use normal saline compresses. They'll make the crust softened and easily removable. And topically, then we can ask the patients to apply mupirocin and fusidic acid. Furuncle or boil. Now this is a deep folliculitis with Staphylococcus aureus, and it generally involves a single terminal hair follicle. The patient presents with painful, tender, erythematous nodules with central pointing, as classically seen in the hairy areas of the body like the axillae, the buttocks or the beard area of the face. Later, these nodules undergo suppuration and there's formation of abscess. This abscess will either burst spontaneously or it can be drained. The ulcer heals with follicular scarring because furuncle is deeper infection of the hair follicles. The treatment includes oral cloxacillin, cefalexin. We should also be giving anti-inflammatory drugs to reduce the inflammation and pain in the patients, and topical mupirocin and fusidic acid. Now against furuncle, we have what is called as carbuncle. Now carbuncle is deep staphylococcal infection which affects contiguous hair follicles, and the very classical site for carbuncle is the nape of the neck. Now carbuncle is a marker of poorly controlled diabetes mellitus. So whenever we come to a diagnosis of carbuncle, we have to get the patient's blood sugar levels done. It is an extremely tender, indurated erythematous plaque which is covered with necrotic tissue. The pus discharges through multiple sieve-like openings, again a very characteristic feature of carbuncle. The deep ulcer is later on covered with eschar. The ulcer heals very slowly with scarring. So the treatment includes escharectomy or desloughing to remove the eschar, and then we need to give higher antibiotics like combination of amoxicillin and clavulinic acid orally and treat the underlying diabetes mellitus. Erysipelas and cellulitis are discussed together. Now, both of them, they are streptococcal infection of the skin and the subcutaneous tissue respectively. There's generally some cut or pre-existing skin condition or trauma from which the bacteria gain entry into the skin. Both the conditions are associated with fever. Now, how do we differentiate erysipelas from cellulitis? In erysipelas, being more superficial as compared to cellulitis, the patient presents with a sharply demarcated, large, bright red indurated plaque which is warm and tender. That is, it shows signs of inflammation. Whereas in cellulitis, the demarcation is not there. It is diffuse, ill-defined swelling with signs of inflammation, and it is non-indurated as compared to erysipelas. Now, both erysipelas and cellulitis are dermatological emergencies. We need to admit the patient in the ward and give them higher antibiotics, either orally or sometimes they may even need IV antibiotics, because if the patients are not treated immediately, then the infection can spread and they can get something called as necrotizing fasciitis and septicemia. Coming to acute paronychia, This is a staphylococcal infection of the lateral nail folds. Remember, acute paronychia is always bacterial vis-a-vis chronic paronychia, which is usually candidial or fungal. Now, acute paronychia is initiated by trauma. There is tender erythematous swelling of the proximal nail folds. It may be involving the lateral nail folds as well. There's formation of an abscess with pus pointing, and there's severe excruciating throbbing pain. So we need to discharge to drain the pus and to relieve the pain. The patients are then put on oral cloxicillin and cefalexin and topically mupirocin and fusidic acid. Coming to acne vulgaris. Now this is a very common disorder of adolescents and young adults. What is the etiology for acne? Well, acne, we all know, is a disease, skin disease of puberty. So what happens during puberty? Well, there's a hormonal spurt, there's an increased androgen production which stimulates the sebaceous glands. So the sebaceous glands, which were lying inactive before puberty, become active and start producing lot of sebum. Because the sebaceous glands become active, there's increased sebum production. At the same time, at puberty, there is hyperkeratinization of the skin, and this blocks the pilosebaceous duct, and this results in the formation of comedones, which are the clinical hallmark of acne. Comedones are the primary lesions of acne. Once the comedones get infected with propionibacterium acnes, which is present on the face, this results in inflammation. Now, what are the grades of acne? Well, grade 1 acne is predominantly comedones. Grade 1 acne, we call them also as non-inflammatory stage of acne. Whereas the other grades, there is inflammation, because by that time, there is infection with propionibacterium acne. So grade 2 acne is predominantly papules. Grade 3 acne is predominantly pustules with a few nodules. And grade 4 acne is severe nodulocystic acne. Now, what are the sites? It is basically the sebaceous areas of the body, including on the face, we have the forehead, the cheeks, the nose and the chin, the chest, the upper back and the shoulders. Now, acne vulgaris can be associated with complications like the lesions may heal with persistent erythema or pigmentation. Scarring is a major problem with grade 2 onwards acne. So the patients can either present with atrophic scars. What they may get is ice pick like scars or hypertrophic and keloidal scars, and this can have psychological disturbances in the patient. Coming to the treatment of acne vulgaris, it is classified as topical agents and systemic agents. And in topical agents, we have topical comedolytics that include retinoids, topical antibiotics like benzyl peroxide, clindamycin, erythromycin, clarithromycin, azelaic acid and nadifloxacin. Then in the systemic agents, we have antibiotics including azithromycin, erythromycin, tetracycline, doxycycline and minocycline. We have oral retinoids, isotretinoin is the main drug, and we can also use antiandrogens like ciprofloxacin acetate or spironolactone in case the patient has some endocrinal disturbances or late onset acne in females. Coming to the topical agents. Now, comedolytic agents are used to correct the defect in keratinization. As I said, comedones are the primary lesions of acne. So, if we use a comedolytic agent, so if the patient has no comedones left, then there cannot be any inflammation with propionibacterium acnes. So, comedolytics form a part of regime in all the grades of acne. Topical retinoids are very useful in all the grades of acne. However, they can cause photosensitivity and irritation, and therefore the patient has to apply this cream at night and for a very short period of time, and gradually we can increase the time. Topical antibacterials, their indication starts from grade 2 acne. This is basically to check the bacterial load. Now this is generally used in combination with topical retinoids in the treatment of inflammatory acne. Coming to systemic therapy, oral antibiotics are indicated for grade 3 and grade 4 acne, and even in severe grade 2 acne, we can use tetracycline. However, it is contraindicated in pregnant women and also in infants. And minocycline, it can cause pigmentation in the photoexposed areas. It can also cause pigmentation of the acne scars. Oral isotretinoin is the drug of choice for grade 4 acne and acne which are not responding to other therapies. Now, this acts on all the levels of etiopathogenesis. This reduces the sebum secretion, improves keratinization, and it also has anti-inflammatory action. But it is not without side effects. The commonest side effect that is seen with isotretinoin is cracking of the lips and dryness of the skin, described as skin rash. Then it is teratogenic. Therefore, it is absolutely contraindicated in women of reproductive age. It can also cause hyperlipidemia. It is hepatotoxic and toxic to the bones. Coming to rosacea, it is chronic skin condition which is characterized by persistent facial flushing, telangiectasias, and inflammatory papulopustular eruption which resembles acne. So how do we differentiate this from acne? Well, rosacea, it is always absence of comedones and the patient always has persistent flushing. In acne, the patient generally has comedones, but they don't have redness or flushing. What is the etiology of rosacea? Well, the etiology remains unknown. However, all the patients have dilatation of small blood vessels of the face. So what are the triggers? It is called as the S of rosacea. That is sunlight, spice, spirit, stress, and smoking can all precipitate rosacea. Also, infection with Demodex folliculorum, H. pylori, vasodilators, red wine, and chocolates are also known as triggers of rosacea. Now, what are the complications? Rosacea can also affect the eyes, that is called as ocular rosacea. So, the patients present with blepharitis and conjunctivitis. Now, because of chronic lymphedema in rosacea, the patients can present with what is called as rhinophyma, where there is fibrous thickening of the nose. Coming to the treatment of rosacea, counseling is very important in these patients. They need to avoid all the factors which can trigger an attack of rosacea. In milder cases of rosacea, we can use topical agents like benzyl peroxide and metronidazole. However, in severe cases, apart from this, the patient also needs to use oral antibiotics like tetracycline, doxycycline, and minocycline, as well as oral isotretinoin, which can be used for severe cases of rosacea.